Today, the College Corner crew are previewing, this is part one of the College Football Playoff Semifinal. We're starting with Alabama and Cincinnati. Avery, I think a lot of people are going to make this your typical David versus Goliath type matchup.
And I think they're right. I think they're right. Diving into these numbers, it seems David versus Goliath. I advocate all year. I want to see Cincinnati in. I hope they can keep this close, but the numbers are just screaming the other side for me.
Yeah, opening betting line was like minus 13. It made its way to 14. It settled at 13.5 over the last couple of weeks. So definitely the sports books are telling us that this game is not going to be close. But at the end of the day, there is NFL talent on both sides of the ball.
Absolutely.
That is crystal clear. So what we'll do is we'll go through, starting with, you know, when the Alabama offense is on the field, we'll talk about when the Cincinnati offense is on the field, and I will do my best to help paint a picture of how Cincinnati could win this game. Because I think there's a path. Teams have shown us the path. Yep. Auburn showed us the path against Alabama. Who was the other team that was LSU?
Texas A&M beat them.
Okay, so let's move to.
I just want one stat before you do this on the field. Alabama, hardest strength of schedule this season. Cincinnati, 45th.
Yeah.
Strength schedule.
Important to keep in mind, especially when you look at like some of these pure stats of, you know, this is their yards per carry, this is their yards per pass. You know, grain of salt in terms of for Cincinnati of who they were playing this year.
Notre Dame's a great win. That's about it.
Yeah, no, completely agree. Cincinnati was not, or Indiana was not a great win, all said and done. And they were tight in that game. So I want to start with the Alabama offensive line. I think that's the biggest thing that people talk about as the biggest detriment to this team throughout the season, where they struggled. We saw it in those games that we mentioned earlier that were tight. Now, there's a few things that concern me, because I think Brian Robinson, the running back group they have, is pretty. I don't think they're very good. I've seen Brian Robinson being mocked to be drafted late in the NFL this year. I don't like their run game. I think that's a big problem for them. What do you think about the offensive line? I think this is the biggest story offensively for Alabama.
They also, you don't like their rush game. I agree. O-line fine. But they only rush on 47% of the plays. It's kind of close there, but obviously it's skewed towards passing the ball.
Yeah.
Bryce Young, they know what they do well, and exactly. It's not running the ball this year.
Yeah, exactly. So like in terms of, there's a stat that I really like to look at. It's called power success rate. Basically what it is the percentage of runs on third or fourth down, 2 yards or less to go, that are converted for a first. They're 76th there. And then their sack rate is 6.4%, 67th in the country. So those are those in the trenches type stuff that they're kind of struggling with. But Bryce Young, being as good as he is, can create plays with his legs, extend plays. We saw it all throughout the season.
I think one of the best things about this Alabama offense is obviously they're number one in the country on third down conversion percentage. They keep their team on the field, and that is a big thing, keeping momentum, keeping your defense off the field and the ability to score points.
Yeah. John, what do you think? The John Mechie absence, I think, is a big thing, because Jameson Williams, dude's like a Lamborghini. Like, he's very fast. He can get off the line really quickly, but I don't think he's really built to deal with physicality. So that could be a problem in terms of this is their big weapon. Without John Mechie, that's a big piece lost to the puzzle. For
Mechie had a ton more catches than Jameson Williams did this season, but it's Alabama. They are going to find someone else to take over. They've got someone that'll
step in. Yeah,
exactly.
Ja'Cory Brooks is a 5-star freshman. Dude's like 6 foot. I think he's like 6'3". I think he has a good chance to step in. They kind of don't have a guy with size. That guy, that Slade Bolden, white guy out of the slot, Hunter Renfro type player. I think he gets a lot of volume. So I think that they've got so much talent. I think there's going to be someone. That's the biggest thing with these games. You got like 3-4 weeks to prepare.
Yeah.
Somebody's going to come out and practice.
Yeah, no, you're not getting injured a week before the game. They have so much time to game plan for someone else to be successful in this game.
Yeah, so I think that'll be big, is who steps up and takes over. Because I think we saw what the biggest thing that Auburn and LSU did when they played Alabama was they put a ton of pressure, you know, sent a lot of blitzes, sent numbers to get after Young, and then trusted their guys in the secondary. They played a lot of press coverage and a lot of man coverage. So I think that's a formula that Cincinnati will need to go with, because their secondary is really, really good. Like, I think, you know, they talk about the measurables in terms of strength, the schedule. I still think this is probably the best secondary in college football. Ahmad Gardner. And then the other kid that won the Jim Thorpe Award for the best corner in college football, Kobe Bryant, is actually another great player for them. So he's like a fifth-year senior. I think they'll really force The best way to do it is to trust the secondary, and maybe they get burned, right? Because you're playing press man against a guy like Jameson Williams. It's going to hurt you.
Some of these stats for the Cincinnati defense, third in the country on opponent's completion percentage at 52%, second in the country opponent's yards per pass at 5.7 yards, and then opponent's passing yards per game, second in the country, 169.
Yeah, minuscule. Teams cannot throw the ball against them, but again, they're going up against the Heisman Trophy winner. The same thing that on those things I had, those exact stats. Ahmad Gardner, 26 targets on the year. That's it. 12 receptions given up, 87 total yards, 3 interceptions. I feel like he's just got to follow Jameson Williams around the field.
What I wrote down originally was he needs to have the game of his life, and I'm taking that back. I don't even think he needs to have the game of his life. He just needs to play his brand of football. He's an unbelievable corner, great football player. And if he just shadows Jameson Williams the whole game, they're not going to target him that much.
Yeah, you want to talk about like upping your draft stock, because he's never really played anyone that he's needed to follow around.
Yeah.
This is an opportunity to either plummet or rise up.
One of these guys is going to go up. One of these guys is going to go down after this game.
Agreed. But Bryce Young, we'll fix it. Finish it with this before we get to Cincinnati's offense. I mean, 43 touchdowns, 3 interceptions, 68% completion percentage. The dude's having an incredible year. And like we said, the offensive line's been struggling, so it's even more impressive in that facet, too.
He just doesn't turn the ball over. Second in the country, interception thrown percentage.
Yeah, that's an important one, too.
It keeps you on the field, man, like taking care of the ball, one of the most important things.
Yeah. And I think they're going to score. They're going to have their opportunities, but I do think there's a chance they start slow, just because I think there's going to be a good game plan here from Cincinnati. But it's hard when you don't have the same amount of talent for it to last for four quarters.
Yeah, both of these teams 7 penalties per game, so nothing there. One's not crazy penalized each game.
Yeah,
so
killing themselves with the penalties.
Cincinnati just can't kill themselves with penalties. I agree.
Okay, let's go to the offense. What do you think of Desmond Ridder and the role that he's going to play in this game?
Really needs to throw the ball.
Yeah.
It is going to be a Desmond Ridder game. Alabama can be thrown on. Like, it's not the same team. Their opponent's completion percentage, 63%, 92nd in the country. There's only 130 teams in this list.
Yeah.
That is not very good. You can throw the ball on this defense.
I think this is one of the worst secondaries Alabama's had. Like, they have Isaiah Battle and Josh Job. They've been around for a little while now. But this is probably the least talented it's been. So this is, I think, 100%, this is the way that they need to attack them and beat them, because, I mean, you have Will Anderson's 32.5 tackles for loss, 15.5 sacks at the linebacker. So that is not someone you want to be messing around with.
Yeah, no, they're 8th in the country in sack percentage as well, this defense.
Yeah, incredibly good. He has, what is Alabama, 10.5% sack rate. And then there's those numbers I mentioned earlier about like power success rate. Alabama's fifth in the country defensively, but Cincinnati's good offensively, 7th. And then another one that I think is going to be important here with Jerome Ford. Interesting story, because he obviously came from Alabama, transferred to Cincinnati. But Alabama's 22% of Alabama opponents' rushing attempts are stopped at or behind the line of scrimmage. That's top 10 in college football. These guys cannot get behind the line of scrimmage and be stuck in situations where they're behind the sticks and behind schedule. So I think Ritter's really important. Alec Pierce, his favorite pass catcher, that's the biggest way that they're going to be attacking this Alabama team.
Yeah, no, and that wouldn't be how they have attacked this whole season. Obviously, Cincinnati, their rush play percentage, 53%.
Yeah, that's
but
my biggest
worry.
But they
also, 6th in the country, 5.5 yards per rush.
Yeah, they run it well. But again, when you go against the AAC and you have the softer schedule, it's like, yeah, it was great. These are great numbers, but you're not seeing the physicality that you're going to see from Alabama.
Yeah.
Okay, so what do you think in this game? What do you think final score is? What are you probably going to be betting on what is it, Saturday? Yeah, games on Saturday.
You don't get rich betting against Bama.
Yeah.
I mean, it feels like, what was that Washington game a couple years ago where they just got absolutely shit pumped? I don't want it to.
They scored 6 points in that game?
Yeah, I don't want it to feel like that, but to me, that's what this feels like. And maybe it's the square play, but it's Alabama. You're going up against the little brother Cincinnati. I think they just wipe the floor with them.
Yeah, I do think that they keep this close for some period of time. I think they have a chance. It's going to be all reliant on the secondary and the defense. I think Desmond Ridder's going to need to use his legs, which he hasn't needed to do this season, obviously because Jerome Ford's been so good. I think that Cincinnati, I'm probably going to be betting them first half plus the 7. If I get 7.5, that would be really nice, but I only see 7 right now. That's what I like. And then I like Ridder if I can find a rushing yards prop to take the over on. That's probably what I'm hitting. I think that they have a chance to stay in this game if they if Alabama can't find someone that breaks out beyond Jameson Williams, because that'll be important for them against this secondary. But yeah, I think Cincinnati has a chance. I'm excited for this game.
I want them to win.
Yeah, it would be a hell of a story.
Yeah,
absolutely. All right, well, that's what we're thinking for CFP semifinal number one, Cincinnati and Alabama. Be sure to tune into the channel. We'll have a preview for Michigan and Georgia, probably everyone's favorite matchup between the two. But thank you guys for watching. Subscribe if you enjoyed, and we'll see you next time.